Fire and have Tom continuing to direct in that interim role. And as nice as it is to see their faces, I think they do sound a little better out here. It's good to hear you all today. We'd like to invite you into our scripture text for today. As we are in the Lent season, it is not inappropriate to look at Old Testament texts. That would have been the scripture text more common, obviously, at the time. And the one for today is fitting for where we find ourselves. A reading from Isaiah chapter 49, verses 8 through 16. And I invite you to look along with me for your insert or your own Bible. Thus says the Lord. Time of favor I have answered you. On a day of salvation I have helped you. I have kept you and given you as a covenant to the people, to establish the land, to apportion the desolate heritages, saying to the prisoners, come out, to those who are in darkness, show yourselves. They shall feed along the ways, and on the bare heights shall be their pasture. They shall not hunger or thirst, neither scorching wind nor sun shall strike them down. For he who has pity on them will lead them, and by springs of water will guide them. And I will turn all my mountains into a road, and my highways shall be raised up. Lo, these shall come from far away, and lo, these from the north and from the west, and these lands from the land of Cyrene. Sing for joy, O heavens, and exalt, O earth. Break forth, O mountains, into singing, for the Lord has comforted his people and will have compassion on his suffering ones. But Zion said, the Lord has forsaken me. My Lord has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her nursing child or show no compassion for the child of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. See, I have inscribed you on the palm of my hand. Your walls are continually before me. Will you join me in prayer? Almighty God, in the midst of this Lent season, in the midst of thinking of Jesus walking those steps to the cross, we seek to draw closer unto you. And so I ask that the words that I speak might be consistent with your will for us. And that if anyone needs to hear a different message, that you might speak directly to their heart, mind, and soul. That they may be aware of the love, care, peace, and comfort that you offer in this morning. For it is in your Son's name that we pray. Amen. So apparently, we are the spring break remnant. Either that or the rapture came and we're all in a lot of trouble. It is probably appropriate for us to be praying for all of our people who are doing so much travel this week. I know you all prayed for me every day, right? When I was gone, y'all didn't forget me, did you? I wanted to make sure I told the Sunday school class I'm teaching, that theology 101 class, that I would be thinking of them on Sunday. And they didn't believe me because they knew I was going to be either at a baseball game or going to a baseball game. And so I sent a text message to Marty Howard and said, just so you know, I'm thinking of you. And of course, I was expecting a nice, sweet message back. Well, you know, I'm thinking of you too. And she didn't answer for 2 days. is to be forgotten. No one wants to be forgotten, do they? Maybe you all were mean kids, or maybe you had friends that were mean kids, and you played hide and go seek, and everyone went and hid, you thought, but really it was just you and everyone else left and did something else. Y'all ever known someone that played hide and seek that way? No one wants to be that person that is forgotten or intentionally left out. We want to be included, and we want people to remember us and think of us and love us and care for us. Can you imagine what it was like for Christ in those days leading up to the crucifixion? Walking those hard, hard days. And what it must have felt like to know what was coming. It helps us think and relate when we hear those words that Christ says on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? Even though, as we talked about in a sermon a few weeks back, the relation to Psalm 22, and that maybe Jesus was actually giving a positive message, a comforting message. We don't know. But what it is to feel in those difficult times of our life forgotten and like no one cares about us. Have you ever been in that spot? Have you ever sat and felt totally alone? Even to the point where you feel like God has forgotten you. We see the poster of the poem that talks about footprints in the sand. And there's two sets of footprints. And when there's one set of footprints, the poem says that was not when God abandoned the individual, but when God was carrying the individual. We have those times of our life where we feel abandoned, and when in essence, God is right there with us, in and through all things that we face. The scripture text that many of us are familiar with, it says, God will never give us more than we can handle. How many of y'all believe that? How many of y'all think that's a bunch of bunk? I just want to see who's saying scripture is not true.
God overestimates my ability.
There you go. But God really doesn't overestimate Tom's ability, right?
Right.
Because in the essence of what we know, when we may feel like God has given us more than we can handle, we are not handling it on our own. It is not more than we can handle with God's help. What it is to be remembered, what it is to be lifted up, even in those moments when we feel like we are utter trash. How many of y'all have ever felt in the spiritual gutter? How many of y'all knew that you put yourself there all on your own and needed no help? Even in those moments when you are in the spiritual gutter, where you feel worthless, where you feel disconnected, where you may not even care about God, does God still care about you?
Yes.
Has God forgotten you?
Never.
Now, I had something in first service. I did it, and it went long in Sunday school, so I didn't get it in here. But before first service, I took my phone and I downloaded Nat King Cole singing Unforgettable. Great, isn't it? I mean, it's hard to get a better voice than Nat King Cole. And I had it playing through the sound system as just kind of a bad music before church started. And I know that Tom is going to sing for me when I die. He's going to sing maybe... Oh, you just walked in. That was pretty good. That wasn't even on purpose. But, Peace Like a River. Some of those songs about peace, I'd love to have Tom sing. But what I really think I want is I think I want to get Tom and Brian Searcy and sing Unforgettable. One, because they sing real well. Two, because I don't want to be forgotten. Three, I want to also have it uplifted in that moment that God never forgets us. And it was so fitting what they said in the choir when they sang their anthem. And it said, God rejoices over you. Wasn't that a great song? Just the words in that song were so perfect. God was still rejoicing over Jesus, even as Jesus prepared for the cross. Don't you believe that? God was grieving, but at the same time, God was rejoicing in His Son, rejoicing in Christ's life, Christ's teachings, and the sacrifice that was to come. Even when He prays, Father, Your will, not mine, be done. There is a minister, Dr. Ken Ulmer, and he tells the story of going to a foreign country. And as he was touring there with the mission group, they wanted to take him to meet this woman who had a gift for weaving rugs. I'm not going to tell y'all how old this individual was, but the way he said it, it was the same age as Hazel. So a little up in years, right, Hazel? And he said they took him to look at this woman weaving, and he saw her feet moving and her hands and everything, and he said, you know, it was all right, but he had kind of seen that kind of thing before. And the person that took him there said, oh, aren't you amazed with what she's doing? And he said, oh, yeah, it's real nice. And they said, you don't sound very sincere. And what he was looking at was the back of the rug. And so there were lots of oddities there. It really didn't look very beautiful. And so the guy took him around to the other side of the rug. And what he saw was something incredibly beautiful. Most of us, when we go through the days of our lives and we look at what we see the underside of that rug, don't we? How many of you all are plenty well equipped? You know your faults. How many of your spouses help a little with that? Maybe your friends, maybe your neighbors, maybe your children. Make us plenty aware of those loose fringes that hang off the bottom of our rug. But when God looks at us, God sees the beauty of the other side. God sees the beauty of what God has created and what God has called. Good. We see what God sees differently. We are blinded by our own failures, by our own frailty, by our own shortcomings. But God has not forgotten the goodness that we are as God's creation, where God created us and God called us
good.
So God is not forgotten you. When you go through your difficult times, God is not mad at you and saying, you know what, I'm going to punish Jim today until he gets it right. No, that's your wife. That's my wife. Right? Those are opportunities, not when we are abandoned by God, but where we have the opportunity for revelation and education. Even in those difficult challenges, God has not forgotten us, but we have the opportunity in the midst of those to be educated in ways we can minister to other people in their dark times, in their difficult times. Even making those alone times a moment where we can be glorified through God in a way where part of the beauty that is on the other side of the rug is what God has done with the mess that we're making on our side of the rug. The beauty of knowing that God is that invested in you, that God is that invested in me. Now, there is a particular passage out of the reading today that has just stuck with me in a deep and a meaningful way as I was preparing this sermon. So I want to point you back to the beginning of verse 16. And to be appropriate, I'm going to read the whole thing. I'm not going to just point out, but I want you to hear these words. Again, verse 16. See, I have inscribed you on the palms of my hand. Your walls are continually before me. God has inscribed you on the palm of God's hand. God does not forget you. God is right there looking at you all the time, rejoicing in you. How many of y'all think you've ever disappointed God? How many of y'all think God done a better job than you have of disappointing God? See, some hands are still up. I think we have disappointed God. Don't you think we also have the opportunity to bring great joy to God? And that's a part of what we're called to do, is that people that have not forgotten where we came from and have not forgotten whose we are. One of the things that we know in looking at that scripture that we are inscribed in God's hand is that God has made us a priority. How many of y'all have ever struggled with anger management? How many of y'all have ever gotten overly competitive in sports or other things? Well, I have known myself for a long time, and this started a long time ago when I was living in Temple, Texas, and I had occasion to get overly involved in something as silly as softball. And so after one particular game where an umpire invited me to sit out the rest of the game and go home, I got a magic marker before I played every game after that, and I wrote all the number 4 and an H and an M on the inside of my thumb, so that even when I had a batting glove on, I could see that little reminder, hey, stupid, it's not all about you. It's just a softball game. You are not called to be some sort of professional softball player. You are called to be a representative of God. And that little message helped me. It's just silly, isn't it? But it helped me. It made a difference. We are right there in God's palm. God does not forget us. In fact, the same palm that God reaches down to us wherever we are in life, that same palm is the same one that through Christ is pierced. Pierced with the nail. The one that reaches out to us and offers us the opportunity for repentance, the opportunity for grace, the opportunity for redemption. Thanks be to God for not forgetting us, for rejoicing over us, and may we strive to make the most of that opportunity for God's glory's sake.